Hello everybody, Dr. Carlo Oyer here. A while back I posted on my channel the intubation of a patient using the Glidescope, and I didn't do any annotations, verbal or written. It didn't really have an educational content. It was just you can visualize the intubation taking place, and there's a value to that, but I think there's much more value once we see it broken down step by step, and then we have a little education related to it. So I hope you enjoy this format where we're just going to walk through that intubation video with you. The first thing to consider in this particular case is, why did the patient need to be intubated? This patient came in with a severe bronchospasm, just a spasm of the bronchioles. In other words, he had severe asthma versus a COPD. He had history of neither. So maybe he had a severe bronchitis and he was really tight. He was using accessory muscles to breathe. He was getting tired, he was breathing heavy. So when you see a patient that looks in distress, respiratory-wise, it's a little clammy, he's working hard to breathe, there's a couple of things you shotgun and you start treatment right away. One thing is, of course, breathing treatments. And in this case, when they're really sick, I use Sopenex right off the bat. Sopenex is basically the level albuterol, the left-handed version of the molecule that causes bronchodilation, that it's within albuterol. A little more expensive, but less side effect profile. It's supposed to be slightly better, especially in severe bronchospasm. So we use Sopenex at a quadruple dose. Normally it comes 0.625. I use 2.5 milligrams in this particular patient with 1 milligram of Atrovent. And Atrovent is a medication you mix in with the nebulized treatment, and it's supposed to lead to more long-standing bronchodilation in addition to the albuterol bronchodilation. Then I gave patient IV steroids, solumedrol, and in addition to that, I gave patient a bolus of IV magnesium. And magnesium is a smooth muscle relaxer, and what it does in the airways have muscles around it, all those little holes, and if you can make those muscles more smooth or weak, then that bronchodilation can happen better. So I gave magnesium, solumedrol, breathing treatments, and obtained an ABG on that patient, an arterial blood gas. And the reason we get an arterial blood gas, especially in sick patients, is because you can evaluate patient's pH, which is an indication of the acid-base status. You can evaluate the CO2 level, which is how well the patient's ventilating or able to move the gases through his inspiratory efforts. And of course, you can look at the saturation of oxygen in his bloodstream. In this particular patient, oxygenation was not an issue. He was being able to saturate well, but he was working hard to breathe. So we're more interested in whether that pH is low or that CO2 is high, whether or not he's starting to have CO2 narcosis, which essentially involves retention of CO2. So this particular patient had a little bit of a decrease in the pH, and he had a little bit of an increase on the CO2. So we started the patient on BiPAP. BiPAP is essentially a pilot's mask that gets tied around the head, and it pushes air in. As opposed to CPAP, CPAP is essentially constant pressure. Imagine you're in a car and the dog puts the head out and he's enjoying the air. And you know, dogs have a long snout, so they appreciate that air going in, makes their breathing better. That's why they like to put their head out of the car. So CPAP means that constant air pressure going into their face, making it easier for them to breathe. Now imagine BiPAP is every time the dog is going to take a breath, you press on the accelerator, giving a little extra boost of air. So in the case of a patient, CPAP will give constant airway pressure, which should help with the breathing difficulty, of course, and help. But BiPAP, essentially, when the patient asks for breath, once the machine detects some negative pressure there, it pushes even more air in, giving an extra boost of air. So we put the patient on BiPAP, this particular patient on BiPAP, and clinically appeared to be getting better. But like an hour later, we repeated the ABG, and at that point, the pH was much lower. The CO2 was going to go up, probably, I don't remember the exact numbers, I'm sorry, but it's probably in the 70 range, maybe in the 80 range. The pH was starting to go down, probably 7.2 something. normal pH 7.35. So we decided that this patient needs intubation because he's failing the other measures to deal with his acid-base balance. He's still working very hard. He's had optimal breathing therapy with magnesium, steroids, and inhalers. So we decided to go ahead and intubate. In patients who we intubate in the ER, we use something called RSI. This is rapid sequence intubation. And it means a series of steps that happen fairly quickly to go ahead and get that patient sedated, paralyzed, and intubated. From start to finish, this process takes maybe five minutes tops, probably much less than that. So we prepare the patient, we let him know he's going to get intubated, and he's going to wake up with a tube, and we're going to make him better. And we go ahead and give this patient etomidate, IV, and a regular size patient, we're talking about 20 milligrams. So etomidate 20 milligrams. And right after that, the patient's sedated and starts getting, it goes down. Then we give succinylcholine. And succinylcholine is a paralytic. It stops the breathing. So the first one makes them, I'm relaxed. And the second one stops their breathing. So now they're paralyzed. They can't breathe even if they want to. So that's when you go ahead and intubate the patient. So let's go ahead and start watching this video of the intubation using the Glidescope. And one of the great advantages of using a Glidescope is obviously that everybody gets to watch what's happening. This little device here, the respiratory tech, the nurses, medical students, as in this case, can watch the intubation take place. So let me go ahead and play this video. And we're recording the camera out of the image so you can see some nurses coming up in this view here. We're getting ready to introduce the blade. And the Glidescope essentially has a camera at the very end of the blade. So right now we're introducing, this is a patient's palate. These are the teeth coming here, and then you got tongue over here. So we're introducing, curving it up. You can see here, this is the patient's uvula coming into view. This is the patient's epiglottis, and the tube, the blade of the Glidescope essentially is a piece of plastic that curves like that. So this little piece is going to fit right here above the epiglottis. So the patient's tongue is going to be here, and the epiglottis is going to be here. So that's where the blade will fit in. And as you lift up like that, then that epiglottis moves up, and you'll be able to visualize right here the patient's vocal cords. So let's see if we can see that. So we're introducing, see the epiglottis right there. The epiglottis. So right there, wow, this is actually pretty cool. You being able to see this perfect anatomy, everybody gets to see this. These are the patient's vocal cords right here. And you can see the opening. So this is where that endotracheal tube is gonna go into. And you can see this, if you get this view, you're golden, you're ready to intubate that patient. All you have to do is start introducing the endotracheal tube here somewhere, and we're ready, and we'll be done very soon. So let's see what we got. A perfect, perfect visualization. You can see the epiglottis falling back. So if I release some of my strength on the blade, which is right here, then it lifts it up, and that epiglottis goes out of view. And then if I pull up, then that epiglottis goes up, and then you can see the vocal cords again. And you can see the tube here coming into view, and you can see that it's kind of hitting this here. And the thing with the intubation through Glidescope, the stylet, okay, this is the endotracheal tube. And this is normally what we use. We use a little piece of metal that's in it to give it some rigidity and help with the intubation. With the Glidescope, the endotracheal tube has to take this kind of shape. So that stylet is curved to remain that shape, because you got to intubate curved going up. And that's what makes it a little trickier to intubate with the Glidescope. It's the only difference between using regular blades and regular laryngoscope. You can see that it's hitting the bottom portion there. Finally, I get it to go in. And this is it. This is the golden moment right here. You can see the endotracheal tube just starting to go in. This is the endotracheal tube cuff. It's a little piece of bubble of air. So essentially, if these are the vocal cords, and the intertracheal tube is gonna go like this, then you're gonna have a cuff of air that's then gonna inflate, essentially creating a seal and preventing that tube from coming out. like that. So once you get that patient intubated, you inflate that bubble of air so that secures the tube in place. And it seals it so that there can be better oxygenation. And now here you can see the tube is in, and then we're going to pull out the camera. And that is it. The patient was successfully intubated. The next thing I'm going to talk about is about how do we confirm endotracheal tube placement and that the fact that we have a successful intubation. So after you intubate the patient, you need to confirm that you have properly intubated that patient and the patient's safe to be monitored and ventilated and stuff. The first way to know you intubated correctly is direct visualization. And with the Glidescope, everybody can see that this took place. You can see the tube going right through those vocal cords and the patient being intubated. So you've seen the tube going through the cords. The second thing you're going to see next is condensation of the air within the endotracheal tube. And this is because the air is warm. When it hits the air in the room, it's colder, you get some condensation. The third thing you're going to notice is chest expansion, which needs to be symmetric, meaning both sides of the lungs, and auscultation. You auscultate both lung fields to make sure that there's equal breath sounds bilaterally and that there's no air bubbles in the stomach. You can listen right over the stomach area and you don't hear blah, 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 blah. That way you know you're within the airway. And of course, saturation of oxygen, the fact that the patient's saturating well, and end-tidal CO2, this is a little piece of plastic, sometimes is digital, sometimes just colorimetric, but you can see a change in color of the end-tidal CO2 test. And of course, chest x-ray confirmation. You do a chest x-ray and you see the intratracheal tube within the airway, and no, it's not too low, not too high. And then, of course, any patient who gets intubated, you should do a follow-up ABG to make sure the oxygenation is adequate, the pH is improving, the CO2 is improving, and the patient's doing well.